Good morning. I'm Mindy Tate, CEO of Franklin Tomorrow. Welcome to our Frank Talks for April 11th. Does anybody know what the national holiday, not y'all, what the national holiday is today? Kathy Rothog.
Hug Your Dog Day,
that's a good way. National Pet Day. It is actually National Pet Day. And so we're here at Williamson County Animal Center, which is brand new, and we're so excited and thankful that they let us come here today. And we also are very thankful to have such a great crowd. And maybe all of y'all go home with a new pet on National Pet Day. That would be great. We would love to see that happen. So we're going to start our program with our monthly feature with Nancy Conway, one of our Franklin Tomorrow board members, on Did You Know? And so come on up, Nancy, and give us your question. And okay, do I have to disqualify anyone in the room for the question?
I have disqualified two people.
Okay.
I did it in person.
Microphone's right there.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Now, the quiz question has a simple answer.
And here's the prize. We actually remembered to bring it this month.
Okay. And it's not as tricky as some months, what I've said. But anyway, here goes. Here's your question, and Mindy will start looking for those that raise their hands first and give the correct answer first. How many Williamson County animal shelters have we had before this one, where we are today?
Anybody raise a hand? Want to guess? Mandy?
One.
Mm-hmm. Incorrect.
Two.
Correct, Jeff.
Yes.
You're the winner.
Jeff Whitby.
Now, just so you'll be in the know, the first one was over behind Franklin High School. And the second one opened in 1995 on Claude Yates Drive, and then we came here to this wonderful Williamson County Animal Center that opened February 14th of this year. Thanks.
Is that okay? That was great. That's great. Well, so the other big news for today is this is the 7th anniversary of our starting our Frank Talks lecture series. And we're just excited that we've been able to be around the community in different locations when we do this event. It's always the second Monday of the month, unless it's like Veterans Day or something like that, a major holiday. We will try to move it for that. But Franklin Tomorrow is a 20-plus year old nonprofit organization, and we'll be celebrating our anniversary this summer, and we're excited about that. But our mission is to engage the community, foster collaboration, and then advocate for a shared vision for the future of Franklin. And if you've ever participated in our programs like On the Table or some of the surveys that we send out, that's how we are getting your input, as well as watching what's happening in local government and seeing how citizens are responding to that and being engaged. But we are a nonprofit organization, much like Andrea's got her friends and other organizations, but we could not do what we do without our great partners. And those include today, we want to talk about Williamson Medical Center, our sustaining partner, and Renaissance Bank, our presenting partner. And so Greg Brory is here from Williamson to tell you, and if you didn't get a stress ball yet, a construction hat, we've got some of those for you, but Greg, come around this way. You have to come around this way.
Good morning, everybody. It's been a relaxing week a little bit for us at the hospital. Last Monday, we started upon the largest expansion and renovation project in the hospital's history at Williamson Medical Center. It's been a stressful time, but, I also mentioned since it is National Adopt Your Dog or Hug Your Dog Day, we're going to have the four-legged friends from Comfort Connections, the Golden Retrievers, if you're familiar with that program, out tonight to the hospital to help our staff kind of, relieve some of that stress. So we've got a few stress hats for our More For You Close to Home campaign and some handouts in the back if you'd like to take a look, but this is going to be a big project that's going to be changing the face of our facility for the next 2 years. and it's going to be touching everything from the emergency department, NICU, obstetrics, cardiac care. We're going to have a new tower. We're going to be renovating the rooms and moving folks around into different rooms while we renovate the older part. So I would invite you to please visit WMCFoundation.com to learn more about this project, and you'll see the on the sheet that we've got handed out at the front and the back what the beautiful new facility will look like. We're glad to be here on behalf of the team at Williamson Medical Center.
Great, thank you. Now, we are excited that for our upcoming April 26th Breakfast with the Mayors, that's a Tuesday, April 26th, at Rolling Hills Community Church, we will have Phil Mazuka, who's the CEO of Williamson Medical Center, talking about the state of healthcare and the expansion project, along with Kathy Montgomery, who is director of the Williams County Health Department. And she'll be reporting on the recent community health needs assessment that's been undertaken by Vanderbilt University Medical Center and St. Thomas Ascension. It's a requirement of the Affordable Care Act. And so she'll be talking about the results of that. And we're excited to have both Phil Mazuka and Kathy Montgomery on April 26th. So Tony Sharp, come on up here. We don't have a funny video this morning, but you know, you got anything to say from Renaissance?
No, just glad to be here and very excited. I'm so glad my wife can't be here because otherwise we'd go home with the dog. So I brought you a check instead, if that's all right. Always glad. This is, I think, our third year sponsoring, so we love being part of this. And you can find us on Columbia Avenue, 815 Columbia Avenue, right across from the police station if you need anything for your financial needs.
Great. Thank you so much. And thank you to the Good Food Group, Jamon Daughtry and his team at the local McDonald's, who is our coffee sponsor for both FrankTalks and Breakfast with the Mayors coming up again. When is that date? April 26th. You'll get a follow-up email today from Lane in the back, Wave Lane. Lane's will be sending a follow-up email today, and she'll give you the link to sign up for Breakfast with the Mayors. So we just have a lot going on, but not as much as these people. I mean, you know? I think that really it's been so exciting for what's happened since February 14th and the excitement in the community about this new facility. You know, we don't just stop with caring about each other as people, but man, we still care about what's going on with our four-legged friends. And so I'm going to introduce Andrea Johnson, and she is the director here, and have her come up and we'll go from there. Emily's going to switch your slides.
Good morning. Thank you, Mindy and Franklin Tomorrow, for coming out. It's fun to have everybody here, and it's really fun to get to use this new room for the purpose that it was really intended, which was to bring our community in different ways other than just coming here to look for a pet. So I'm glad to have you all here this morning. I know a lot of you, but for those of you who don't know me, I'm Andrea Johnson. I've been the director here since 2018, and it's been a very exciting time to be involved with the Animal Center. So back several years ago, I believe in 2016, was when Mayor Anderson put together the task force to talk about building a new animal shelter for Williamson County. And he formed the task force from a lot of different areas of the community. There were veterinarians and, of course, shelter staff and other areas, other folks in the community who were interested in animal welfare, who got together to talk about, you know, let's dream big. What would a dream that we don't think we could ever accomplish look like? And 3 years of a task force and several years of, it feels like an eternity of building. I can't even imagine how many hours actually went into making this building a reality, but I will tell you that with very few exceptions, the dream that we had as part of that task force actually became a reality and is in this building. So it was quite a labor of love, but the end product we're so proud of. So why did we need a new building? So the old building, as they told you, was built in 1995, and at that time the population of Williamson County was 97,000 humans. So obviously we've come a long way since 1995 as a community, and not only did the population more than double in that period of time, but the way that we think of animal sheltering has changed drastically. The future of sheltering and actually the present day sheltering is not to just have a place where you can warehouse animals. It is a place where we can serve our community and engage with the community around different things besides just adoption. So we have a lot of ability here in this building to engage the community and assist the community. Everything from a pet food pantry for folks who are not, you know, maybe it's a temporary situation where they're struggling to feed their pet, or maybe it's they found themselves with too many and a permanent change. We do partner with One Gen Away and also with Graceworks to provide pet food in the community. So that's just an example of ways that we can create programs here in this building that will help not only the community, but will help keep pets out of the shelter. So the whole goal of this building is not to warehouse animals, it's to keep animals out of this building. So you may ask, well, if you want to keep animals out of the building, why did you need such a large capacity, such a large building? Well, nationally, you can predict how many animals you will need to intake every year. We call the number of animals that come through our building our intake number. Nationally, there is an average of human population as it relates to how many animals your local shelter will have to house and process every year. So we know this building was built for a 20-year lifespan. We know that in the next 20 years, there are predicted to be over 500,000 people in Williamson County. So we had to build a building that would accommodate a certain percentage of animals through the building every year based on that projected population number. But as you go, if you tour the building after this morning, you'll see there are lots of spaces that are created for programs. Programs are what will allow us to not have to build an addition and warehouse more animals here. So all of those programs that we are talking about, this, our community education program, we have community outreach, where we're engaging the community in a new and different way here in this building. So I could talk all day about the geeky things about this building, but Scott was helpful and told me some things that aren't boring that you guys might be interested in hearing, because I can sort of get too deep in the well here with spending 3 years with architects. Has kind of skewed my vision of what people are interested in. But some fun facts about our building. We and Scott and Sam are going to talk to you also. Scott Pieper is our community outreach coordinator, and Sam Anderson is our community education coordinator. But one of the things you'll notice when you tour is our cat enclosure areas do not have bars. They are glass front and glass backs. We want to try to get away from in sheltering sort of that institutionalized, you know, jail type feeling. We want to have a different experience and a different engagement with the animals, and so that when people come in, it's not a sad place to be. It's a happy place to be. It's hopeful. There's lots of possibilities for every animal that come through here. We have 8 free roaming cat rooms. Each one of those rooms will house up to 9 cats. So when you go back through the free roaming rooms, you'll see each one of those rooms has a pet door where the cats can access an outdoor enclosure called a catio. You'll see all the climbing structures, everything that you see from the litter box containment units to, you'll see structures that are mounted to the wall for the cats to climb on. Those were all provided by our nonprofit group that supports us called Friends of Williamson County Animal Center. So they paid for 100% of those extra structures that are there for the cats. This building actually was a public-private partnership. I probably should have touched on that. So the county obviously is obligated to provide animal control for the community, and that is our function, why we exist, is for animal control, which is enforcing the state and county laws related to animals as well as the rabies aspect of that. So if someone has a bite or if there's a suspected case of rabies in the county, that always comes through us. So when you hear somebody say animal control, that is us, but it's only one small part of what we do. You'll notice as you go through the building that the dogs are in not really a separate building, but they are separated by a hallway, and that is for not only the level of noise that OSHA says is acceptable in a working in an office environment, but also it's not stressful to the cats because they don't have to hear the dogs barking all day long like they did in our old building. We had in the, you know, times have changed so much for shelters, because in the old building, the cats were in a room that literally shared a wall with the back of the dog kennels. So it was just bark, bark, bark all day long. And we all sort of got used to it. But when you would have a hound or a husky was in the shelter somewhere, you knew it, because there's lots of howling. We have a clinic here at this new building that is funded partly by private donations. The Calvin and Marilyn Lehue established an ongoing fund that will fund, and we do public spays and neuters over there. That is one area in our county that all the people that run people-based nonprofits here in this community can tell you that we are so incredibly blessed and we have so many resources in this community, but we don't have, there is a drop-off for folks where services, you know, if you need certain things, Davidson County has more of those services than we do because they have a population that utilizes those more. So we have a real heart here to make sure that if you want to get your cat or dog spayed or neutered, cost should not be a barrier. And we have free programs, we have low-cost programs, and anyone in the community can access spay and neuter services through this clinic here. And when a member of the community comes and pays a full price for a spay neuter, it helps offset the cost for someone who maybe will need to access free care. So those are some of the things that you'll see when you walk through the building. Lots of space for just our employees to have a better experience as well. I mean, in the old building, I always tell everybody, Sam actually had her desk in what used to be a bathroom. The shower stall was where she kept her filing cabinet. The work that we do here is hard sometimes, and can be stressful. And so having a nice place where you can go back to your desk and get access to natural light and not have a lot of barking and loud noises is also very helpful. What was I supposed to talk about that I haven't touched on?
The livestock.
Oh, yes, yes. Everybody's interested that we actually have large animal holding areas back in the back now. In the past, when we would get the random pig or goat, which our county attorney is always cringing when she hears that we have a pig, because we're really here for dogs and cats, and we weren't set up for them at all in the old building. But we do have a livestock holding area back there now, so once in a while, you do have a stray pig or a stray goat that we get a call about, and we'll go out and pick them up in our animal control trucks, and they go in the dog compartment, and then they come here. And so now they'll have a nice outdoor place to be housed and won't have to be in a concrete dog kennel. So that's going to be nice. And I think that's it. It's 35,000 square feet. Scott's going to talk about how many cats and dogs we can hold. And there's a lot to see and a lot to do. And I think hopefully you guys will stay for a tour afterwards. And I think you'll be very pleased with what the county has done here.
Do you have any questions for Andrea now? And kind of speak up so we can hear it, or Andrea repeat the question. You might have a question?
So with the pandemic, obviously, a lot of people are adopting, mm-hmm. So your numbers seem like they were low.
We had very low. You know, it's interesting that, I mean, I don't know. I'm interested to look at the data, actually, and see. But it feels like our adoptions have slowed down. During the pandemic, we couldn't keep enough animals in the building for the number of people who wanted to adopt. It was not unusual for us to have only four or five dogs in the building at any given time. But now that I think people's lives are sort of getting back to normal, it feels like the adoptions have slowed down a little bit. But we still have obviously lots of capacity here because it's supposed to grow with us for the next 20 years. So, I mean, you'll see a lot of empty kennels when you go back. It's not, you won't feel like it's full, but I think we had 13 dogs in adoption last Friday. Now we have almost no cats because it's not really cat season. There is a season for cats and shelters. It will start very soon, but we have about 50 kittens right now, I think, in foster care. So kittens start to be born usually in April, and that season usually runs until about November. So we'll start to fill up with cats here pretty soon.
Mandy, it's not a question, it's more of a comment and a thank you. My grandkids come to see me like four times a year, and they're 10 and 8, and I had told them all about the new center, and Andrea was kind enough to say we were bringing our donated animal food. The granddaughter loves cats, and the grandson loves dogs, and so Andrea's staff was awesome. They were still in the process of moving animals. We got to come in and take a tour and play and give our food, and it was just an amazing place. So I too would encourage you to do the tour, because and I'm very grateful we have that in this community.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you for what you do.
I was just wondering, like, what is the best way for kind of the average person to help? You talked about nothing and just getting pet foods. Is it buying things from your wish list? Is it volunteering? Is it bringing things for the pet pantry?
Sort of all of the above. So we always need volunteers. I mean, we have a very robust volunteer program, but the dogs in particular require a lot of attention and detail. And one of the things, and I don't think it's in anybody's presentation, so I won't step on any toes, but one of the things that we do here is we have a pretty structured volunteer program for dogs. They get out at least four times a day. They go to a play group Monday through Friday, which is, probably the most enriching thing that we do for their mental health. When you go back through the dog kennels, you'll see the kennels have an outdoor area that's open air, and they have an indoor area that's air conditioned and heated. And that's it. The whole building is designed for the mental health and the physical health of the animals. All of the areas are on separate ventilation systems. When you open a door into cat adoption, but it's where the air gets sucked up through the vents instead of coming out at you. And that's to, you know, obviously keep down on smells and change the public experience of the shelter. But our volunteer program, Our dogs get walked every single day, at least three times a day, plus a play group. And it's very, it's a very structured walk. It's a very structured program. So if you love dogs and you have some spare time, we can always use more dog walkers. Many hands make light work and less dogs to walk. So any other questions?
Do you have to be a Williamson County resident to adopt?
No. You do not have to be a resident of the county. You do have to be a resident of the county to surrender a pet here. We only take animals from within the county, with the exception of the Murray County side of the city of Spring Hill. We do take, we do have a contract with Spring Hill for animal control services, and that includes strays and owner surrenders within the city limits.
I happened to get a tour here by Penny. It was great. I don't know if you guys have a chance, but I noticed you guys also had puppies. And maybe you want to let people know it's just not older dogs, but you have puppies coming in once in a while. So people may not know that about this place.
We do.
My name is Samantha. I'm the community education coordinator here. I've worked here for almost 7 years. So I've done a little bit of everything in the building, from intake, adoptions, social media, to education, which is one of the newer departments here with this new building. Before we got here, we did not have any kind of space to hold educational opportunities such as this one. We would have crammed you all into our tiny little lobby, and you'd probably all be standing right now, and we wouldn't have anything like this to show you, you know, graphics and things like that. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the services that we provide here. There's a long list, so I might not touch on everything, but in the back on that table there is a whole list of the things that we provide. So I'll start with education. We've just restarted our Book Buddies program that we did, I believe, from 2018 to 2020. The pandemic stopped our Book Buddies program, and we just started last month. So that's for kids ages about 5 to 12, where they can come in and read to our cats. So it provides them an opportunity to read to a non-judgmental animal, and it provides our cats some socialization. You know, every animal is different when they come here. Some, especially the cats, can have a really hard time with that transition from a previous home to the shelter, so it can be really helpful to our cats as well. The only requirement for that is that child and parent or guardian attend an orientation, and then after that they can come and read anytime during Book Buddies hours. We're also doing scout programs. Right now we have a class for brownies so they can get their pet care badge, and we're trying to come up with more classes as we speak. So we're hoping to utilize this education room as much as we can. Some other things that we do that you might not know about is in the past 2 years we've started a kitten rescue and rehome program. I used to do the feral cat program here, and what I was finding is that people would find kittens and they would care for them for weeks and weeks, and maybe the mom was there, maybe it wasn't, but then they had been caring for them for so long they wanted to rehome the kittens on their own because they really formed a bond with these animals and they really cared about where they were going next. So we decided to provide everything that the kittens needed, spay and neuter, rabies shot, everything that they need to be successful, and then give the kittens back to that person so they can then rehome them on their own if they would like. So that's really a win-win. We keep the kittens out of the shelter. people get to see where these animals are going that they care about and they've cared for so long. So that's been something new here. Some other things that we do that you might not know about is, let's see, we, like Andrea said, we are offering more spay and neuter. So we do free spay and neuter for any outdoor cats, and then we do pet cats and dogs as well. And it used to be that you only, if you were in a certain income bracket, you could use our services. Now we've got a bigger scale, so many people can now utilize our services at different prices, which we didn't have before. Like Andrea mentioned, we have our pet pantry once a month. So if you ever need help getting food, you're welcome to come and get some. And then we also do low-cost rabies shots and microchips. We usually do that the last Saturday of every month, so rabies shots are $10. And microchips are $15, and you can bring your animals in to get that done. Of course, we have our animal control officers, and they do everything from patrol for stray dogs to helping with dangerous animals to facilitating like our bite quarantine and our dog bite investigation. So they are always, we have four officers that are always all around our county. Picking up animals, assisting animals, different things of that nature. And then, of course, we take in strays and owner surrenders, like Andrea mentioned, and we do adoptions. And the other thing that we provide that we don't talk about a lot is we do provide low-cost humane euthanasia for pets. If you've ever had to put your pet to sleep because of old age or maybe, you know, they are too aggressive to have in your home, it can be pretty costly. So we do provide that service for only $50, and we do it in the most humane and compassionate way that we can. Am I missing anything? Any questions? Yes?
On the Book Buddies program, do you bring your own book, or do you have books for cats?
We have books here, and you can bring your own. So we recently were able to purchase a lot of new books with a wide variety of topics that the kids can read to the cats.
Tell Two Kings is a good one.
Oh.
I don't know if we have that one. Anything else? Okay, thank you.
Sam is doing a summer camp this summer for the first time in conjunction with Parks and Rec. Oh, so it sold out in less than 48 hours, I believe.
Oh,
so.
Wow. Oh, wow. Missed that. It's not
the most. All right. I am Scott Pieper. I'm the Community Outreach Coordinator. Unlike Andrea and Sam, I waited until the new building was being built, and we had a move-in date to start working with the Animal Center. So I've been with the I started last May, so coming up on my year anniversary with the Animal Center. But, yeah, thank you all again. I just want to reiterate how much being community outreach, how much this room means to me, and seeing everybody here. Thank you so much for joining us. How many people, is it your first time here? All right. Nearly everyone. All right. Very cool. Well, so Andrea and Sam have told you about the new facility and the programs and services that we had. I am going to kind of wrap things up by talking a little bit about the impact that all of those things have together, by sharing some statistics, and then I'll close by sharing ways that people can get involved with the Animal Center. So. The statistics that I'm going to share are from 2021, the most recent year. And all right, I thought I was going to share statistics. Oh, it did change. It didn't change up here. Sorry. Okay, so yeah, so our mission statement, all the statistics that I'm going to share are all in the ways that the services, programs and services have had an impact on our mission statement, which is making Williamson County, Tennessee better for animals through adoption, education, enforcement, and pet population control. I think when people think about the Animal Center, automatically, intuitively, you're going to think of adoption and animal control. But as Sam talked about, education is part of our mission as well, and we're excited to be doing all the things in this room and the programs that Sam has started, along with pet population control. So in this building, we have the capacity to hold 88, 90-ish dogs at any given time, and around 160 cats. So that space is needed when you consider that on average, okay. Oh, there we go. All right. So on average, can you tell I did this morning before everyone showed up just to make sure it's working? So on average, we have an intake of a little over 4,000 animals per year. Cats, we typically have more cats than dogs. So as you can see, we had almost 2,800 cats in 2021 that we brought in, 1,269 dogs and 158 others. So yes, as Andrea touched on, we do any animal that comes to us from Williamson County. So that could be the most common are what we call the small furries, the guinea pigs, the hamsters and mice, things of that nature. In my time here, probably the most exotic animal was a bearded dragon. We actually have had snakes, and as the larger animals that we now have the ability to hold here as well. But and this has been a pretty busy year for rabbits as well already. So, and
we don't have any right now.
So it's more than just cats and dogs. In our live intake, great. All right, just making sure. All right, so our live release rate, 96.9% last year. We've been right around the 97% mark for years now. And what that means is that 97% of the animals that come in are leaving here alive. And that's through adoption, return to owner, could be transfer to another rescue agency to meet special needs of an animal. Particular breeds might do better if they're with an organization that focuses on that particular breed. Behavioral or medical conditions, they might be transferred out as well. But our number one goal is if we get an animal brought to us by us as a stray, our number one goal is to get that animal back to the owner. So we'll do things, of course, microchipping. We'll check for microchipping. We will use our social media platform. We post pictures of the stray. And we have roughly 43,000 social media followers. So it's really quite impressive to watch. You mentioned Penny earlier. She does our social media. She'll post a stray when it comes in, and within an hour, it's been shared like 3,000 times, and people are tagging each other. And so all of that leads to, for our dogs, we're able to return about 40% of the dogs that come in as strays. Cats, we return about 7%. Which obviously is significantly lower, but when you compare that to national averages of return for cats, the national average is around 2.5 to 3%. So we're doing really well compared to national averages for return. Uh, All right, it's not moving on here now, so that's why I'm checking. All right. We talked a little bit about the spay and neuter programs that we offer. We did over 3,000 spay and neuter surgeries here. Almost 1,200 of them come from the community cat programs that Sam talked about, which are free spay neuters for any cat that spends any time outside. And that's extremely significant. When you think about, it's estimated there's around 50,000 cats in Williamson County that spend at least part of their day outside. And if you take that even in the step further, where a single cat left unspayed or neutered can be responsible for 400,000 cats within 7 years. So think about what that would look like if we weren't providing these services. So that really just does emphasize the importance of the spay and neuter programs and why they're needed as much as they are. Of course we do. Enforcement, animal control enforcement is part of our mission. Our officers answered nearly 2,600 phone calls last year. And that could be anything from someone reporting a stray that they're seeing, bite incidents, or they also will help local police officers. If police are involved in a situation where there's an animal that they need to be taken care of before they can do what they need to do, they will call our officers and they will go assist the police with that. All right, so I'm sure everyone by now is asking, how can I be involved? So I'm going to walk through a few of those ways for you. Volunteering, we talked about that. In 2021, our volunteers provided over 21,000 hours of service. Dog walking, socializing cats, some administrative help, helping at events, just amazing ways that our volunteers are amazing in the support that they give us. So, and I don't know if you break that down, that's over 10 full-time employees, that the number of hours that they get. So they are very essential to what we do. And I'm going to share how you can get information about becoming a volunteer, things of that nature, right before I wrap this up. All right, foster parents. We rely heavily on fosters, particularly in kitten season, as you know, which is coming up. We had 960 animals placed in foster care before they were adopted last year. So when we get kittens, I'll use kittens as the example because they're the most common. They're typically not old enough or healthy enough yet to be adopted out. So they will go into foster care until they can be. And that's generally, 2 months and 2 pounds? It's basically 2 months old and 2 pounds is what we want a kitten to be at in general before they can be adopted. So when we get a litter of kittens, like I said, they're more times than not, they don't meet those guidelines yet, so they will go to fosters. One of the really cool things about our fostering program is everything is provided. So food, medical supplies, litter, crates, housing, anything you can think of, we provide to our fosters. So there's really no out-of-pocket expense that'll be necessary, just the space, time, and care for the animals. And of course, donations. We have Amazon and Chewy wish lists that are updated regularly by priority. So if it's at the top of that list, that means that we're saying this is a priority need for us. We take lightly used in-kind items as well. They can be dropped off at this. We have collection bins at the near the front entrance. They can be dropped off at your convenience. It doesn't have to be during business hours. Unless you would want a gift receipt, then we would have to be there to give you that. We have sponsorships. You can sponsor kennels, You can sponsor different area, like the play areas, the catios. We have sponsorship opportunities for that. We also have a paver program, which you may have seen as you were walking in, where you can memorialize or honor a loved one, pet or human. And it'll be placed with the others here up front. And of course, monetary donations. We accept all of those. A really simple but effective way, as I touched on earlier, to help us is to follow us on social media. I mentioned, you know, how quickly our social media, the word of mouth spreads by social media for the strays and how effective of that is. I mean, it really is a help just to follow us on social, share posts, not only to help return strays, but also to help us spread the word that we are a resource for the community. We'll post programs when we launch new programs. We'll share those online, and it really is helpful just to help us spread the word about what we're doing. There is some information, flyers and pamphlets and stuff in the back, along with all of our business cards and other ways to get in touch with us. Information about all of the things that I just talked about, how you could get involved, is on our website. You can go to adoptwcac.org. There's really detailed information about how to sign up to be a volunteer, how to join Book Buddies, links to the Amazon and Chewy wish lists that I mentioned. It's all there on our website. So thank you all again so much for being here. I truly do appreciate it.
We have time for a few questions.
How many employees are actually in the department or at your facility?
We have 36 positions.
They're
not all filled right now, but 36 positions, yes.
For the food donations, like we recently had a dog that passed away, but we had a half a bag of food. Do you accept open bags or does it have to be sealed?
We do accept open bags as long as they're not expired. And the food that we receive from donations goes towards our Paul Pantry program.
And I know the One Gen Away folks are here, and when you do a food giveaway, you'll want to tell us, you know, that's food is available for the pet as well as the
human. It is. When we have that available, yes. You'll find out that the elderly would rather feed their pet than they would themselves. So when we get that, we definitely help at our distributions and also donate here.
I have a couple of questions and a comment. And with Graceworks, we also give out food at our food pantry. So we try to help people keep their pets. One of my questions is, forgive me, I was late. I don't know if you covered it. Do you offer any behavioral classes? You know, I know a lot of people relinquish their pets because of behavioral issues that might be easily resolved. Some of them
we're repeating it for the camera. Do you offer any behavioral services for pets? Or for the owner as well.
So we partner with Project Reward, which is a local nonprofit that does provide. Project Reward's mission was to keep dogs out of the animal shelter. And so the way they started out doing that was to offer free group classes to anyone who adopted a dog from any animal shelter. It didn't have to be us. But actually, we are going to start, first time ever, free group classes for the public and their animals. It doesn't have to be an animal adopted from the shelter here at our building. When you go through, you'll see we have an indoor training area, which also was paid for by the Friends of Williamson County Animal Center. And so we're working right now on getting that very first class scheduled. So thank you for that question, Valencia.
And let me follow up with a question similar. You were talking about the pandemic and the impact that it had on people adopting, but also it really was because it's a mental health benefit to have a pet, right? And so
tell us a little bit about what you know about that. And I just love that the cats get read too.
Do you have anything that you want to cover on the mental health piece? We're actually working on that right now, and Sam has actually been tasked with that because Kathy Montgomery from the health department asked us to work on that. So Sam's been spending some time with that issue.
Yeah, so animals can be used in a lot of different capacities for different reasons. So some children with autism will ride horses, and it will help them with that. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Some therapy offices will have dogs, and a lot of schools in Williamson County are now starting to incorporate dogs into their schools. So there's still a lot of research going on about the mental health benefits that pets can have. And of course, that doesn't even include companionship in the home. I know that cats purring even has been shown to slow your heart rate. That's just one thing that I know about. Yeah, animals can be used in a lot of different capacities for different things, from reading to mental health therapy.
Great. Any?
Do you play music for your animals?
Do we play music for the animals?
Sometimes we do play music for the animals. This building actually has the ability to have music played throughout. There's actually the ability to play different music for the cats than for the dogs. But I have not quite figured out. I'm not that technical, so I haven't quite figured out how to make that happen. But we do play music throughout the building quite often. And it's interesting because the staff actually said that one day we just had music, you know, just piano music going, and the staff were really actually enjoying that and feeling like that was helpful to their day as well. So we have a lot in common with the animals in the building.
Great. And Valencia, one last question.
What's your volunteer hours? Like, are they 24 hours? If I can't sleep one night, can I?
And volunteer hours. It's structured. It is structured, but you have morning and early morning.
The Sunrise crew starts walking dogs at 6:30 a.m. And Sunrise goes from 6:30 to 8. Then we have a break for cleaning. Then we have 10 to 12 walks. We have 12 to 2:30. We have play groups. And then we have the last evening shift, which is from 4 to 6. And that shift is actually probably the busiest because you not only are walking dogs, but you're working with adopters. So if you are interested in coming out and say, well, I'm not really wanting to work to walk dogs, but I wouldn't mind talking to people and helping them select an animal, whether it be a dog or a cat. The cats, obviously, we have a lot of cat volunteers as well, but their times aren't quite as structured. You know, they can kind of come and go throughout the day.
And obviously, Franklin and Williams County have a great relationship with our neighbor Mars Pet Care here. Do you want to talk a little bit about the benefits of having Mars Pet Care and being a better living city for pets?
Thank you, Mindy. I would have been remiss if I did not mention that Mars actually feeds all of the animals in this building. So when you give a donation, yes. When you give a donation, it goes to the pet pantry. So if you bring in a bag of cat food, that cat food bag will be shared with someone who needs that help for their pet at home. Mars feeds all of our animals, and they're so generous. I mean, we put in an order every month that tells how many animals we have in the building, how many we project to have. Animal shelters thrive on data, and we can kind of guess what our population is going to be for cats and dogs for month over month each year. So Mars is actually, as you walk out to the lobby, you'll see the Better Cities for Pets mural in our lobby. We partner with them a lot you find us with them at Main Street Festival and different events throughout the year. So we love Mars.
Great. So who is excited to go on a tour? Yeah. Oh, look at this. Oh, that is great. Just a couple things that we'll talk to you about. Just remind you, our next event is April 26th. breakfast with the mayors at Rolling Hills Community Church, and we're excited, as I said, to talk about the state of health care in our community and the expansion at Williamson Medical Center and the community health needs assessment. Then May 9th, I believe, is the date for our next Frank Talks, and we'll be back out in this area. We'll be at West Haven at the Residence Center, and we'll be talking about mental health in our community, and so we might have Andrea bring some cats just so we can all sit there and pet them. breathe. But we want to talk about mental health in our community again, because it is such an important topic. And we just hope you have a great day, and we hope you get excited and maybe take home one of these cats or dogs that are here for sure. So thanks so much, or whatever that is over there, I don't know, or the unusual pet. But don't buy the bunny unless you plan to take care of the bunny. Don't buy the bunny for Easter, okay? Don't do it. Thanks so much. Have a great day. Don't buy the bunny.